Well, greetings from the workshop. This is the ammunition box I've been working on to put on that wagon. It's all ash. Almost 2-inch ash, actually. She's heavy. But it won't fall apart, and it is a wagon, you know what I mean? So it's supposed to be strong and all that crap. Anyways, I wanted to talk to you today. Haven't made a video for a little while. Figure, well, it's about time, eh? On this site, I don't know, I was watching somebody's video and somebody left a comment and they mentioned this site. So I went to the site to check it out, you know. Man, I'm telling you. People. My whole life, you know. Yeah, I was raised in religion, you know, organized religion. Christianity. And you know, there's a whole segment of people out there in Christendom. They got the weirdest friggin' beliefs you could ever imagine. They read the Bible, but they don't have the Spirit. The Spirit is truth. They read it, but they don't understand it. It's like Isaiah said, you know, they'll be ever hearing, ever seeing, and never understanding. And boy, was he right. Was he ever right. They don't get it. They don't deserve to get it, you know, because they're not sincere. That's the only thing I can put it, you know, they're not sincere. Peter, he said something interesting one time. I think it's in 2 Peter. I'll put it on the bottom. He said that the people he was speaking with, that he knew that they belonged to God. And you think, well, how did you know that, Peter? What are you, psychic or something? And he said, no. He said the reason he knew was because that when he brought the gospel to them, when they heard the gospel, he said that they repented and accepted the gospel with great conviction, the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Well, God is Spirit. The Spirit we call God is truth. The Holy Spirit is truth. When the truth came to them, they accepted. They believed. And this is how he knew that they belonged to God, even though they didn't understand or know anything about God prior to that. Isaiah wrote, blessed are the feet of those who bring the good news. Paul wrote, if someone doesn't preach, how are people to hear? And how can someone preach unless they're sent? Well, who are they sent by? Well, the Old Testament says they're sent by God. Jesus said that he would send, speaking to the Pharisees who rejected him and crucified him, the people who said, let his blood be on our heads and on the heads of our children for all time. He said, I'll send you priests and prophets, wise men, teachers. And he says, you'll hound them. You'll chase them from town to town. You'll persecute them. You'll hamstring them. It's an interesting little point. To hamstring an oxen. An oxen, of course, is a prophet, a person, a teacher, you know, someone who's bringing the truth, someone who understands. To hamstring an oxen is you take his leg. I can't get my leg that high. And I don't think you'll be able to see it, but the back of the hock, above the hoof part, you know, the ankle, you take and you cut the tendon. You don't cut it all the way through, you just cut it partly. And it makes the animal so that it hurts to walk. It can walk, can get around, but it ain't running away. and it ain't moving none too quick, you know. They hamstring oxen as they please. You know, in the Old Testament, it's talking about that the oxen they hamstring are men. The Old Testament saying the same thing. Or the New Testament, I should say, saying the same thing. They don't consider truth. Truth being God. Father, truth is God. So, on this site, they wrote me back. I wrote them and I sent them the gospel. And they wrote me back and they said, you know, well, if we don't disagree, or if we disagree, you know, don't worry about it, you know. Read page 2223. You know? I didn't go that far on my first encounter with this site. So this time I went to page 22. And I read page 22, page 23, page 24. Absolutely disgusting. They made a comment in there that if you believe that when you die you're going to face a bearded man with scars in his hands, holes in his hands, and holes in his feet, and a scar in his side, if you're going to think you're going to meet a bearded man, you're nuts. What a bunch of assholes. What a bunch of God haters. They think that truth and love is what we can understand, what we can glean from our knowledge of good and evil, and thereby operate in, and that love is what the world defines as love, you know? Kissy, kissy, huggy, huggy, I won't hurt you, you won't hurt me. Wow. That is not what Jesus meant when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Father God is truth. He's inflexible. Truth doesn't give an inch. A lot of people on the net, you know, they say that, oh, your God is a real ogre. Yeah? Damn right he is. You tell me, you look at truth and tell me where there's flexibility in truth. There's no flexibility in truth. There is none. Truth is a dictator. It's this way or the highway. If you follow truth, you'll be blessed by it. It's like a campfire. Campfire, you build the fire. Truth is the one, you know, you need a fuel, you need oxygen, and you need an ignition source. You need heat. You put those three together, you get fire. Who made that a reality? Who made that principle correct? Truth, Father Truth did. And you think that, no, I've kind of lost my train of thought there for a second. Sorry about that. Battery went dead. So it's the next day. We try and finish this video. So you think that you can just have any fuel, any amount of oxygen, and any ignition source, and you'll always get fire? No. Everything's got to be exactly right. It's got to be exactly the right fuel, exactly the right ignition source, exactly the right oxygen, amount of oxygen, in order to have combustion. Different things combust at different times at different rates. Everything's got to be perfect. That's the way truth is. Truth is not just, we'll throw it in the air and see if it works. No, it's got to be right. So, people accuse God of being, you know, mean. Well, here you are, you've got life, you're living. And if you want to keep living, you got to do it right. The earth's got to stay a certain distance from the sun. Too close, we fry. Too far away, we freeze to death. What are you doing, Bubba? And it's just the way it is. Anyways, this site, I got a squirrel here I got to take care of. He's in my friggin' coat pocket. Get out of there. You want some of these? Here, you come and get them over here. He can smell the peanuts in my pocket. Come on. Come get them. And he wants some. Anyways, this site on the internet, and an awful lot of people I meet, they seem to think that God bows to them, that they tell God what to do. I'm afraid that's not the way it works. Man doesn't tell God what to do. Man is not God. Man is not the authority. God is the authority. You can either follow him and be blessed, or don't follow him and be cursed. But don't blame God when it doesn't work out the way you want it to. Don't blame God. I was watching some video, and they were talking about Twitter, and there's some guy named Ricky Gervais. He thinks he's a comedian. He's about as funny as a catching AIDS from a blood transfusion. And he's a real comedian, all right. Friggin' asshole. That's what he is. He made some nasty comment, some snide, not nasty, but snide comment, you know, about the tornado in Oklahoma, you know. Everybody says, pray for the people of Oklahoma, he says. I sent money. And he thought that was smart. Smart ass, that's all that was. He thinks that he's doing more by sending money than other people do by praying. Prayer is a petition to God. The gift that God gives mankind is understanding. Understanding God. Understanding truth. Understanding life. He mocks God and says, oh, God's an ogre. God sent this tornado. Well, you got to think about it, you know. If you live in a floodplain, you could pretty well expect it to be flooded out. If you live in Tornado Alley, you could pretty well expect that you're going to get hit by tornadoes. Man blames God. These are the weather patterns that God creates so that the whole world continues. And we blame God when a tornado hits us? Maybe it's time people understood that if you're going to live in Tornado Alley, build houses appropriate to where you live. Put your houses underground. Or if you want to have, you know, your stick-built 2x4 slap-it-together house, I guess the only other choice you have is at least build an underground shelter where you can put your family when the tornado comes. And buy plenty of insurance to keep rebuilding your house. Either that or move away. Move somewhere away from Tornado Alley. You know, this is not rocket science. When people say pray for the people of Oklahoma, it's the same as we say up here, pray for the people in the Red River Valley. Good grief, if you're going to live there, expect the friggin' Red River to overflow its banks every year and flood you out. It's fertile, yeah. But it comes at a cost if that's where you want to live. Pray people understand the cost and deal with the cost appropriately. Deal with it appropriately. Yeah, come and get it. I got your peanuts right here. He wants to run all over the place and make a big fuss, but didn't want to come get the peanuts I got sitting out for. He wants me to give them to him. Yeah, up yours. Anyways, truth is inflexible. Truth is a scrupulous bridegroom. Very scrupulous. You don't want to marry no whore. No bitch who climbs into bed with falsehood and copulates with the devil every time it suits her lust to play God. That's not what he's after. He's looking for a bride. He's looking for a people like himself who can operate, function with a bit of reason and a bit of logic and in love. Put it all together. Truth, you can't separate love from truth, and you can't separate truth from love. You just can't. It's not possible. Come on, bub. Here. Here. Come on. Yeah. He's got his own ideas. And above all, Jesus is truth and love in flesh. The Word, the truth, as it was written by the prophets, about his appearing, all the conditions that had to be met in order to show that this is God in flesh. This is how God did it. He revealed his word, his truth, to the prophets. He said, write it down. Come on, book. Here. Come on. Come on. Here. Stop being an asshole. There. Good sakes of life. If you can't see love being displayed on the cross, the man that can't see that, God, I pity him. I pity him. God came down, gave his all for us. Because, you know, we're sinners. And truth is inflexible. So Christ is our mediator. Between the inflexibility of truth and the love of God. He's our mediator, Jesus. And as he rose from the dead, he says that all who believe in him, he's the sacrifice for our sins. All who believe in him will not perish, but live again beyond death. And yeah, in a functioning body. Just as he rose from the dead in a functioning body at the resurrection, we rise from the dead in a functioning body as well. This idea that, you know, God is just spirit, no one's ever seen God, no one will ever see God. Guess what? Yeah, we have seen God. Jesus is God. He's not a man. He's the immortal, living God appearing in mortal form. Put to death, but risen immortal once again. Next time, guys. Love you. Where are you? You want a peanut or not? Goodness sakes, I'm not going to be your bitch, you know? Here. You do with them. Here, come and get it. Come on. Come on. Come on. Here, come and get it. Chicken shit. Here's a couple more for you.